Mike's next stop is the Bahamas, where he'll learn everything he can from Dr. Sam Gruber, the scientist who first discovered tonic immobility in sharks. They're heading to Doc's field lab on a remote island corner where there are plenty of sharks. No one in the world is more qualified to teach Mike about tonic immobility than Doc Gruber. Like Mike, Doc believes sharks don't deserve their bad reputation. Doc wants to show Mike how he uses tonic immobility. He wants to start with a small shark, so first they head off to the shallow waters of a coastal mangrove forest.
Woo, that's cool.
Doc trails a bag of fish chum to attract the sharks. There should be plenty here, because these mangroves are a favorite place for baby lemon sharks.
The current will bring the scent of the chum down to the sharks, which are down 100 yards or so, 100 meters or so.
The bait is working. Here come the sharks. The little sharks are hungry and play straight into Doc's hands. It's easy to handle now, but this shark can grow up to 12 feet long. Next stop is the field lab, where Doc's colleagues are about to test their latest batch of chemical shark repellent. They're about to put tonic immobility to work. Doc shows Mike how to turn the shark upside down.
I know it's hard to believe, but it's true.
Soon, its body becomes catatonic.
When you turn a shark upside down like this, it's completely odd. It's an odd posture that they never get into normally. Now, once she's in tonic immobility, her visual fields are reversed and her gravity is reversed. And I think this produces a kind of a sensory overload, and the brain secretes serotonin, and that is what's correlated with these states of immobility.
I can touch the eyes, bend the dorsal fin, even touch the gills, and there's no response. This must be a very deep trance-like state.
Now with the shark in tonic, the scientists test their shark repellent. There's no reaction to seawater, the control. Then they try the shark repellent. It's this kind of reaction that just might save millions of sharks.
We realized very quickly when we started testing this stuff that it was specific to sharks and that regular bony fishes would not be affected by it, and it immediately presented the possibility of saving about 50,000 sharks a night who are captured by mistake on long line.
If bags of Doc Gruber's repellent could be attached to fishermen's long lines, they would deter sharks coming in to grab the catch and end up dying themselves. Doc wants his repellents to protect humans too, by mixing it into surfboard wax or sunscreen.
Shark attack is blown out of proportion.
Yeah.
So humongously, so tremendously, that it's you just can't imagine where that comes from.
Well, I think it's the media. If there's a shark attack,
But the media wouldn't write it if the people wouldn't read it. You know what I mean? There's something going on there.
Yeah.
Really deep down in our psyche. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know what that is, but The thought of being ripped apart by a shark is much worse than by a lion, for instance.
Well, apparently, somebody did a study, and shark is one of the five words that generate the most fear in us.
Yeah. Except out there in the Hawaiian Islands, your word shark is one of the words that develops awe and respect and love. It's a cultural thing.